My name is Jane Tylus. I teach in the Department of Italian Studies. To be here to introduce our presenters for this evening in honor of my dear colleague Maria Luisa Ardizzone's brand new book from the University of Toronto, Reading as the Angels Read, Speculation and Politics in Dante's Banquet, which just came out last year. It's not for me to talk about the book, that's for our distinguished guests and Professor Ardizzone herself. But I just want to say a few words about Professor Ardizzone, who I've known since I came to NYU in 2003. And indeed, she's one of the reasons why I left the University of Wisconsin at Madison to be here in this department, to be in the company of exacting and exciting intellectuals such as herself, and to be inspired by her thoughts on everything from the lyric poetry of the Scuola Siciliana to Montale. And I have not been disappointed. What I didn't necessarily foresee was an incredibly generous friend who would welcome me and my husband and our sons to her home many times in the lovely village of Cilatica, where we spent some wonderful summer days and evenings together. It's been a pleasure over the years engaging with Maria Luisa and with her work, reading her many essays and books, from her translations and commentaries of Ezra Pound to her Guido Cavalcanti, The Other Middle Ages, to Dante, Il Paradigma Intellettuale, which enacts a fascinating dialogue between Cavalcanti and Dante, and now to Reading as the Angels Read, which is a learned, groundbreaking book on perhaps that most enigmatic of Dante's works, his unfinished Convivio, and written from the perspective of someone who is deeply grounded in the poetic tradition of the Middle Ages, as well as in its philosophy, its theology, and its science, and someone who reads the Convivio not only as poetry and prose, which it is, but as a work that links poetry to the political and to the social, as Professor Ardizzone demonstrates how Dante seeks to create a community of like-minded readers. And I think that all of us in this room tonight, thanks to her work, can now become that kind of community that Dante so desperately sought. Now, as many of you know, NYU is lucky to be part of a consortium here in New York, connected to our sister universities, especially CUNY and Columbia. And just as our students collaborate by taking courses at other institutions, so do our faculty do the same through their collaborations. And with Maria Luisa Ardizzone and her principal interlocutor tonight, Teodolinda Barolini, we have a wonderful collaboration on Dante, the Global Dante series, that has now been ongoing for several years, in which Teo and Maria Luisa together oversee a series of talks and symposia. This year is on the Vita Nuova, vero? In
no.
April, no? De Volgari Eloquenzia, mi dispiace, allora, on the De Volgari Eloquenzia in April 7th. In the past, they have done other texts of Dante, and so far, I believe, one book of collected essays, Dante and Heterodoxy, or am I missing one? Okay.
No, she's with me.
Okay, I'll let you figure that out, but a wonderful work, Dante and Heterodoxy, has emerged from one of their early gatherings, and there will surely be more such publications. So let me introduce Teo Barolini, who really needs no introduction in this particular community, but I'll just say very briefly that she is a Lorenzo da Ponte Professor of Italian at Columbia. I won't go through her many books and honors, but I will just remind us of some of them. She's the author of Dante's Poets, Textuality and Truth in the Comedy, with its Italian translation, Il Miglior Fabbro, Dante Poeta della Commedia, and her book won prizes from the MLA and the Medieval Academy. She's written The Undivine Comedy, De-Theologizing Dante, also translated into Italian as La Commedia Senza Dio. And she's the author of Dante and the Origins of Italian Literary Culture, which has also had an Italian translation. Her commentary on Dante's lyric poetry, Rime Giovanili della Vita Nuova, came out with Rizzoli in 2009. And an expanded and revised English edition came out with Toronto in 2014. She's also the editor-in-chief of the Columbia University website, Digital Dante, and author of the Commento Baroliniano, more than 600 pages of what I understand are idiosyncratic and personal commentary on each canto of the Commedia. And she has recently edited a volume of essays on her father, the poet Antonio Barolini, called Antonio Barolini, Cronistoria di un'anima, to which Professor Ardizzone has also contributed an essay. Teo is a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Naval Academy of America, among many other honors, and we're delighted she came downtown to be with us tonight. Now, I'm about to close. This conversation was to have been joined by two other faculty members from our sister institutions. Unfortunately, Simone Marchesi from Princeton was unable to join us tonight, but we're very fortunate to have with us Alessandro Vettori, who's here from Rutgers University. He's a professor of Italian and comparative literature and a creative writer as well as a scholar. Among many things, he's the author of Giuseppe Berto, La Passione della Scrittura, La Città nel Decameron di Giovanni Boccaccio, and Poets of Divine Love, The Rhetoric of Franciscan Spiritual Poetry. He's published a number of short stories. He recently held the Benjamin Meeker Visiting Professorship at the Institute for Advanced Studies at the University of Bristol, and he is a Cavaliere della Repubblica Italiana. So we will welcome first Teo and Maria Luisa to begin their conversation, and then they will be joined shortly by Professor Vettori. Thanks to all of you for coming. Thanks, as always, to Stefano Albertini and our staff here for enabling this event to happen. But mainly, thanks to Professor Ardizzone for writing the wonderful book that will be the topic of this evening.
Stand at the podium when it's going to be a conversation. Okay.
Ora vediamo.
Siccome tu parli più a lungo, quando tocca a te.
Va bene, va bene. Tu? Ah, perché bisogna parlare là. Va bene, io parlo. No,
allora lo rimetto.
No, è molto facile. Voglio questo.
So.
That's beyond me completely. First of all, let me thank Professor Tylus for her exceptionally kind words and say that it has been an extraordinarily fertile period in the collaboration between Columbia and NYU since Professor Tylus and Professor Ardizzone have been here, and it's really been a delight to work with them. And the Global Dante Project of New York, which is entirely a brainchild of Professor Ardizzone's, which may be like a spirito in veggio negli occhi della donna mia, ballata 26 of Cavalcanti, therefore a spirito of cognition, not the subtly medical type that we find in the other Cavalcantian works. In that respect, I really do believe that to have participated with her in this brainchild of the Global Dante Project has been, for me, an extraordinary adventure. And I'm very happy and grateful to NYU for providing this impetus. Just to go over what the trajectory is, since we are nearing our yearly appointment, which is scheduled to go on for, I believe, 7 years in total. It started in 2015 with the Monarchia. Then we went back to the beginning of Dante's works, and we did the Vita Nuova last year. This year will be the De Vulgari Eloquentia. And in one way or the other, then we're going to get to 2021, when it will be all the Commedia, of course, all the time. But tonight, we're here to celebrate this work. Reading as the Angels Read, Speculation and Politics in Dante's Banquet, University of Toronto Press, 2016. And it is a remarkable achievement and an important one. And I'm going to try to just create a little bit of the sense of the bibliographical history around writing on the Convivio so that you can appreciate a bit of what is at stake before asking Maria Luisa to tell us something about the intellectual journey that led her to this. So just since I'm going to not assume that all of you know about the editorial and bibliographical history of the Convivio, I'm just going to, and maybe for some of these, this is just a reminder, the Convivio is, as we heard from Professor Tylus, an unfinished treatise. that Dante wrote after his exile and before starting the Inferno, so likely before 1308 and likely somewhere between 1304 to 1308. Of course, we have no actual dates, but it's in that period. And it is a treatise that consists in its unfinished state of four books. The first, an introductory book where he explains why he believes he should be writing this banquet for those who are unable to benefit from philosophy firsthand, and rather than have them just have the crumbs that might fall from the table, he is going to give them a more robust meal. And that's what he's setting out to do. The first book explains the causes that he, the reasons that he has decided to do this. And then he says that there are going to be 14 other books. At times I've been grateful that there are not 14 other books, but of course, that's only because we then do get the Commedia, and maybe had he written 14 other books, he wouldn't have gotten to that. So as it is, after that first introductory book, we only have three other books. And the particular conceit of the Convivio as a text is that each book, prose, begins with a canzone and purports to gloss the canzone as it goes off into its philosophical speculations. So that's the structure of it. And it has a complex editorial history because maybe because it was unfinished, it was never circulated in Dante's lifetime. And it's really not till the Quattrocento in Florence that we begin to have a sense of it. A very famous copyist of the Convivio is Antonio di Tuccio Manetti, who transcribed it between 1460 and 1470. And he is the person who also, for the first time that we have linked Boccaccio's Canzone di Stese to the unwritten books of the Convivio, speculating that those canzoni would have been the starting points for all those later unwritten books. On this topic, the topic of the editorial history, we hope that Beatrice Arduini of the University of Washington is going to publish a monograph. She did her dissertation on this topic, and I read the dissertation, and I think it will be extremely useful in the growing world of convivio studies to have that editorial contribution. In fact, the Convivio doesn't have a robust history of monographs, which is also why this book is so important. It had monumental editions in the 20th century, and the one that most of us cut our teeth on is the Busnelli and Vandelli edition, which really had come out in the 1930s, but which we all cited in its 1964 second revised edition, which was revised by Antonio Enzo Quaglio. That's the Convivio I cited in my first book. By the time my second book came out, I was citing Cesare Vasoli's Convivio in the 1988 Ricciardi edition. Now, each of these editions is monumental, but it's not the same. A commentary, having done one now, is a different thing. It's a different creature from a monograph. So we have these great editions, but actually in all this time, there had been no books devoted just to the Convivio. The books, as I was thinking back over the years and thinking of what I had read, actually I could only think of one title of a book, not an article, that even had Convivio in the title prior to recent times, and that's Nardi's Dal Convivio alla Commedia, Sei Saggi Danteschi, but they are indeed Sei Saggi Danteschi. It's not a cohesive monograph. Gilson's 1972 Dante la Filosofia is an important contribution here. But really, it's an interesting lacuna that waited until very recent times to begin to be filled. And it's, I think, Paolo Falzone's book of 2010 is Desiderio della Scienza e Desiderio di Dio nel Convivio di Dante, is the first monograph I can think of to simply be devoted to the convivio. And then following that is Ardizzone's reading as the angels read, which actually picks up on her paradigma intellettuale. So one of the things that I hope to do, have done in giving you this brief history, is to give a sense of the monumentality of the achievement here, because it is really going into uncharted territory to simply take the convivio and attempt to analyze it per se, not in the service of the commedia, but on its own. So that's where I would start from. And then I have marked passages that I would be happy to ask Professor Ardizzone to gloss for us. But I thought actually that I would begin, since she has such an interesting intellectual itinerary, to, if you would like, to tell us the story of how you got to this book.
The publication or the writing?
The writing, the intellectual story. Okay. All right.
Thanks. Thanks, everybody, for being here, and mostly thanks to my colleague, Jane Tylus, and Professor Teo Barolini for such introduction. The itinerary to arrive to this book. Okay. I have to say that I have been involved in, for many years, in the work of Ezra Pound. But I am a medievalist with no job for many years. And so I had the luxury to study just for study, which is something good, and not for having a position. So I spent a lot of time thinking and rethinking about certain things. Pound, of course, was fond of Guido Cavalcanti, and I have started working in his archive in Yale, and rethinking the Italian culture and medieval poetry, mostly, in Pound's American perspective. And some categories were too narrow for Pound. And I started to follow his steps. And the first thing for me was Guido Cavalcanti. No Dante, Guido Cavalcanti. And Guido Cavalcanti opens a pathway as extremely difficult to be followed in its profundity and specialization. Cavalcanti required tools not just of rhetoric, of poetry or poetics, but also of logic, medicine, philosophy, and all this learning was active in his work. Every word implied a deep search. And Guido Cavalcanti, according to Boccaccio, was one of the greatest logicians in the world. Nobody has taken this issue seriously. I did. And it was evident that his major canzone is organized with structures of logic to be understood, for instance, the sophism, or not the usual syllogism, but sophism, for instance, which was thought to be just deceptive, but actually in the 13th century, sophism became instructive. This is just a footnote, but a footnote in the history of medieval science, medieval philosophy, sorry, medieval logic, but is extremely important. Contini thought that Guido Cavalcanti used the sophisms in a way which is deceiving. Instead of Cavalcanti used in another way the sophism, he applied logic to physics, the so-called natural demonstramento. However, at the end of the work on Guido Cavalcanti, I was sure I wanted to start immediately to work on the Convivio. The fame is that there is a link between Guido Cavalcanti and Dante of Convivio. So I was looking for, I have to say that I have spent a lot of time just copying passages of the text, trying to understand. And at the end, I started by writing this book, which took 10 years. This is something I say not with pride. Maybe I was too slow. But I have to say that this is the thing. And why? Because every word in Dante, in Dante's Convivio, yes, of course, proposed a theory about that. That is that prose has to be written like poetry. That is, the prose of the Convivio requires so much commitment to be understood. And okay, so I did. Thanks.
I think you should stay there, because after all, the questions are to you. So I'd like to ask you, on page 35, you say that you talk about the political nature of the work, and you say that this is an aspect of the Convivio that your book introduces and that has until now never been taken into consideration. Would you like to elaborate on that?
Yeah.
Politics.
Okay, I have to say that the title, Reading as the Angels Read, was a part of my courses. I am happy to see here Paolo Reni, Sara Diaz, because they were my students. Now they are my colleagues. And I have given these courses because I was investigating the theory of speculation in the poetry of medieval poetry. And so the title is To Read Like the Angels, and the epigraph I quote in the first page is Augustine, who writes in the Confessions that the angels read a book, and such a book is God's mind. God is just mind, but he stresses the aspect of the idealistic approach to what is God. It is strange to say I did not give the title to my courses thinking to Augustine. I did not. But the idea was that in the mind of God there is something to be read, which is research made by many medievalists, the idea that the world is a book, and also God is a book. Augustine is a part of this tradition. So the book is on speculation. During my work on the Convivio, I understood that Dante is not satisfied with the concept of a speculation which is detached from politics. I was surprised, but he always is not straight when he writes the Convivio. The most difficult thing is this. What is central in, you did not ask that, but I have to say, and what is central in the Convivio is what I call the ethics of doubt. Dante constantly goes back, is uncertain, and he shows his doubts. So for that, it was difficult to follow his pathway. And however, it is evident that Dante does not think in terms of, because the Convivio is more or less the story, there is a kind of abstract, okay, there is a kind of abstract story, which is the love of the narrator, the character who says I, for the gentle lady. One of the first things I understood while working on the Convivio is that we cannot
not identify the story of the Convivio as Dante falling in love for philosophy. And this is a common issue. I am extremely reactive against a reading common. Dante falls in love for philosophia. No, Dante falls in love for the donna gentile, which is another thing. He restricts. He is limited. Donna gentile belongs to the canzoni, which are commented in the Convivio, and to the literary commentary to the canzoni. Dante introduces philosophy in the allegorical commentary. If we read step by step what Dante writes, the Convivio comes out as a problematic work in which the definition given by scholars, the encyclopedia of learning, which is the Convivio and the goal of the Convivio, disappears. And this is one thing. The second is, it's true. All the work testifies Dante looking for the possibility that a human being has of a contemplation similar to that of the angels. That's the title, the first part of the title, contemplation or speculation. But the other part of the title, which implies politics, derives from the fact that the model of the angels Dante puts forth in the first canzone, voi che intendendo il terzo ciel momente, that is commented in the second treatise of Convivio, implies contemplation and action. Intendendo means to have intelligence, desire, and for that the movement of the events is created. So contemplation implies action. It's such action in the angels, it's long to say, but the knowledge of angels is a theme discussed by everybody since the time of Augustine, implies in the century in which we have what is called theology as a science, that is the link between the metaphysics of Aristotle and the theological background of Christianity, we have that contemplation, speculation of the angels provide life in the earth. So this is a model which we should say is philosophical, theological. Dante tells us where he learned such learning. We know that it was also partially condemned in 1277 in Paris. However, the other aspect is Dante starts with this, but he proceeds because at the end what he wants to show is the human being is able to have a perfect intellectual knowledge like that of the angels. This is a tradition which deals with, of course, Neoplatonism, the pseudo Dionysius the Areopagite, but it's also in Plotinus. I mean, it's an enormous amount of knowledge converge on that. Dante knows some of these texts, some not, but at the end, when he establishes that probably the human being is able to have an intellectual knowledge, not perfect like that of the angels, but discontinuata, as he writes, we are aware that he is entering in another field. So the most interesting thing is that this search shows that Dante has infinite sources, reads different books, draws from different sources, organizes a new learning, is a new intellectual because he wants to give us an idea of a human being who shows a dignity which foretells the Renaissance approach to the human being. This is the first step. And then politics. Okay. The angels move and generate life, move the heavens, and through the heavens, life is generated and maintained in the earthly world. But Dante deals with another idea. Now I have to enter in something more specific. You wanted to ask another question, I will say. Politics implies the idea that the human beings, just if they think together, they think at the best. So implies community, life in the polis, implies the sense of politics. Of course, the basis is the discovery of Aristotle's politics, and also the discovery of a thought which is not Christian, but Dante uses in a different way. A thought that has attracted people like Albert the Great, has been, of course, opposed by Thomas Aquinas. In this thinking, the human being alone cannot fulfill his own dignity. The human beings need to live together. From that derives what for me is one of the most modern aspects of Dante's Convivio, the construction of the structures which allow human being to be a human being in the highest sense of the word. Sorry, it's so long.
No, it's good, it's good. So, I think I was going to ask you about where you write that speculation or perfect intellectual knowledge is the result of communal thinking, but I actually think you just addressed that.
Yeah, is it precisely? No, thanks. I can say just two words. Which are the texts here? The first is Dante's Canzone 3. Treatise 3 and the Canzone 2, Amor che nella mente mi ragiona, in which he discusses the issue of how many people can have love for this lady. He says, gente. I have started to follow the development of such a word. Of course, Dante has utilized it also before in the Vita Nuova, for instance, gente who love Beatrice. So these themes war inside him. And also the Vita Nuova can be read as a work in which the sense of politics penetrates, because the death of Beatrice is something, a mourning for the city, not just for the individual. And he writes to scrissi agli principi della terra, he writes there, and why the principi della terra have to be informed about the death of Beatrice. However, now going back to the convivio, which was the question? Community. And okay, this is a very, very important issue of the convivio. The fact that if human beings together are able to contemplate the donna gentile, this donna gentile is preparing the pathway for the human beings who think together. Dante will write that in the Monarchia. The convivio at one certain level is the urface of Monarchia, no doubt. This is another issue, very, very complex. Why? Because we cannot understand the certain positions of the Monarchia without understanding what happened in the convivio. And also that it changes the focus in many occasions, but because he has un pensiero dominante, to say that with the Leopardi. He has something in mind, and this is what has in mind is the idea that is not the individual the subject of history, is the civitas, the polis, people who think together. For instance, the theme of friendship in Dante becomes something extremely important. He takes, of course, the basis, he starts with rethinking Aristotle, who in the book, books 8 and 9 of the Ethica, the Nicomachean Ethics, writes about friendship. Friendship is the relationship for polis, for politics. And then this idea that just in the civitas, in the community, human beings develop themselves. So the love for the donna gentile, detached from the love for philosophy, introduces an enormous amount of things. Theo, may I say, sorry?
I have a question.
Oh, not now. You have to ask?
We finish here.
Sorry.
This is a genuine, not a prefabricated question, which is, if the object of the convivio is to make a community and to make the point that we think better in a community, why does you make the point frequently that his, as I'm citing you, his answer is concealed?
He does not speak clearly.
In another place you say his style is at once plain and obscure. So how do you connect the desire for community with the communication?
Very good question. Thanks, Theo. No, the point is that he does not want to teach. He does not want to teach to community. No, he looks for a community. He wants to have what he will write in the Monarchia, Humanitas, as a new subject of history. But he looks for the formation of a reader, which is different. He wants that the reader can be formed on the convivio. This is one of the main points of my reading in this is also proto-humanist education for political life. He wants this, a new class, not barons, as has been said, the women. Okay, he mentions them, but it's evident that this reader has to form himself. And the medieval culture is shaped on the idea, and Dante is a part of that, both in rhetoric, in the use of rhetorics, in the use of poetics, of philosophy, that it is the difficult which makes intelligence. This is in St. Augustine. This is in the Poetrie of the 13th century. Dante recalls that in the Vulgari Eloquentia. He speaks about ornatus difficilis, precisely, which creates the intelligence of the reader. So it doesn't, it's not so clear. Also because, from one side, is giving to us a culture. So difficult. Maria Corti said we lost the keys of the Middle Ages culture. And this is true. We have always tried to reconstruct something which has roots in the classicality, in other times and culture. And in addition, the commitment to the difficult is crucially important for Dante. This is a theory I have discussed not just now, in articles, also in the book of Paradigma Intellettuale. Okay, I see that you are not satisfied by my answer. I see you. I know that you want to oppose me. Do that,
no,
please.
Not if not. I wouldn't even dream of it. I am, though, a little perplexed by your emphasis on a trobar clous.
No. I did not say that.
Well, you actually used the word closed quite a few times.
No, close is not trobar clous. I mean, of course there is this tradition. I think that trobar clous is poetry.
The prose is written.
I don't like this microphone. That's the problem. Okay. Thanks. I think that No, the difficult I'm looking for is a totally different issue. In the poetry, for instance, Geoffrey of Evinsauf, Matthias van Dom, and etc., we have what is called ornatus difficilis, which is coincident with transumptio. The students who have taken courses with me know perfectly that I am extremely interested in such issue. The ornatus difficilis links in the study made by Boncompagno da Signa, who has written a treatise on rhetoric entitled Rhetorica Novissima, is of the first half of the 13th century, links a tradition which is also in St. Augustine with the tradition of the so-called ars poetrie or artes poetrie, and ornatus difficilis is coincident with the transumptio. Transumptio is a complex rhetorical figure because it is made by 10 figures. Among them there are, for instance, prosopopea, allegory, metaphor, pronominatio, nominatio. Okay, Dante uses all these instruments to set up what? Something he does not want to confront, or whoever he has to confront. How much the theory of the intellect in the philosophy and culture of the 13th century is contaminated by the thinking of Averroes. This is a theme I have explored in many ways, is in the Convivio. So when he conceals, I don't believe that also Siger of Brabant said that the truth has not to be concealed, but is not explicit. Maybe the function of Cavalcanti works because he does not want to agree with his first friend on such issue. In fact, he, at the end, finds his own way. And this is evident in the Convivio, third treatise, and it will be repeated in the Monarchia, but in a different way. That is, the human being alone as a kind of intelligence, intellectual knowledge, which is limited. Thinking with the other beings, he can have understanding. This is not the position of Averroes, does not imply all the things which in the philosophy of Averroes are implicit, like theory of matter, materialism, the death of the individual soul, as you know, for Dante's Canto 10, etc. No. But in Dante, the idea that human beings are powerful because they think together is crucially important, is, I think, at the, it's a core, one of the main points of this book, of this work, which has many different centers of meanings. This is one of the things, so there is not one center. Yeah.
So I'm very struck by the degree uninterested in certain things that seem to me somewhat related to your topic. Your subtitle is Politics and Speculation. What about, how do you connect his exile to this?
He's in exile.
I know, but does it figure into your reading in any way? How would you relate the circumstances of his life to the writing of this, given how you read the Convivio?
Do you think that his biography has to interact with his
theory? I would be curious if you thought it did.
He, of course, he is looking for a city in which people can have not just life but also intellection together. Also, monarchy deals with that, not in this way, in a different way. I mean, perhaps the search could be that, the point could be that a new society, a new interaction between human beings
which can be, from one side, biological. He follows Aristotle's step by step from the meeting of man and woman and marriage, etc. But at the end, he looks for a community which not just interact biologically, but also intellectually. This is the idea of the polis in Dante. So, of course, it's utopic, but is crucially important.
Well, he begins the convivio very, very soon after at the very beginning, in the first chapter. He talks about what would have been of him if he had been born in a polis that did not have a university, and he had not had any access to books.
He makes a distinction between people who can have access and people who... But means what this is, sorry.
It seemed to me, as I'm listening to you, all these topics seem to me to be
too much abstract. Yeah, the book is constructed on abstraction.
Abstract philosophical narration.
Yeah, for sure. And I have to say also that there is something I wanted to stress. However, I mean, this is for people who are in the field. Never has been discussed the issue of the theory of the ideas in the mind of God, which is, of course, crucially important in the convivio. Dante writes about that. Nobody has taken seriously that. Nardi has seen that, but he does not discuss at all. I mention him for that, and he's just interested in showing how much he can be heterodox, which is not the case. He's not heterodox. He looks for taking from the field of heterodoxy what is useful for a new idea about life. People think together. I remember I went to a symposium, a conference in Göttingen. There was a great scholar of the Middle Ages, Thomas Ricklin, a young man. I have just learned he died. I don't know why. And I did have a fighting with him that lasted for half an hour, I think. At the end, we became friends. And he said... He was working with other people on an edition of the Convivio, book two he worked. So he was opposing me, and I was extremely grateful of this discussion. And at the end, he understood that probably there is a point, precisely if we take step by step, we start to follow this idea of abstract, to know the ideas in the mind of God, and the Donna Gentile, Theo knows perfectly, that is an idea in the mind of God. Dante writes that in the canzone Amor che nella mente mi ragiona. Theo, you have written about that. So, this idea is extremely important in the economy of the book, Dante's book. If the human being is able to know an idea in the mind of God, is like the angels' intelligences. If this is true, and that's the problem, what in the human being is able to know that? The human mind. This human mind, Dante writes, here the ethics of doubt is crucially important to understand. Dante writes, I am not able to reach the knowledge of this lady. And he shifts between a singular subject and a plural subject. In this sense, he conceals, because instead of to tell us clearly, he uses the language in order to put us on the pathway and allow us to understand what? That he uses many different sources to create a mosaic of something totally new. The author of Convivio does not deal with the theology just, does not deal just with the philosophy, not with the classicality, the auctores. he does not want to create a conciliation between theology and the philosophy. No, but he puts the text's close and allows the reader to create his own idea about things. This is.
I think that's one of the most beautiful contributions, is the idea of the reader that you outline in this book. Do you want to talk any more about the creation of the reader, or shall I pass the baton to Professor Vettori, who has been so?
Oh, okay.
So, if you want.
Thanks.
Yeah. Well, I hate to interrupt this very. Fruitful and productive exchange, and I hope that we'll go back to it, because I have learned a lot from it. Even having read the book, there are many different points that can be elucidated. So, but I would like to pick up on the metaphor of the itinerary, because Teodolinda started with that, asking you what your intellectual itinerary was, and that was really enlightening to me, and I think that there are multiple itineraries here in the way that, for example, Teo was evoking Dante's exile, which of course is in itself an itinerary too, but I'm talking more specifically about the reader's itinerary that you portray here in the book, and first of all, I would like to say it's I congratulate you. It's a very and I echo the others who have already spoken. It's a very, very complex topic that you tackle, and I must say I haven't read anything so complex and philosophical in quite a while. And I'm still struggling with a lot of the, and it's my fault. It's not that the book is unclear. It's totally my limited understanding of some of the issues at stake. But one of the things that I found most interesting was the reading practices that you you talk about, and how basically it's through the reading of the Convivio that readers are educated. And Dante does this very subtle operation that by which he instructs his readers as they are reading his book. So I would like to hear a little bit more about that, but in specific, I would like and of course, you know, we all read with our own intellectual abilities and our own intellectual background, and mine is primarily Franciscan, and so at some point, well, many different points, you bring up Bonaventure, and there I see a different itinerary, because of course one of his major works is the Itinerarium, Mentis in Deo, and so I would like to hear more about how you use Bonaventure. Because I think there's more than what you point out in the sense that when you talk about the vestiges, the vestigia, right?
Yeah.
The vestiges of God were present in the world, and how the senses perceive the vestiges of God in the process that I think Bonaventure calls contuitio. So if that falls in that category of reading instruction that you highlight.
I use Bonaventure. No, I don't use this part of Bonaventure here, but I have used the Bonaventure for the discussion about memory. In the books, in the second treatise, Dante discusses the issue of the donna gentile, which is in front of him, and Beatrice is on the back. And I have to say that this has been one of the most difficult passages to understand. From one side, scholars say that the Donna Gentile is in front, and this has to be related to the part of the brain which is in the imagination, the activity in which is the, there is the activity of imagination. The other part, at the same time, Beatrice is on the back. What he wants to say, it's obvious that we cannot resolve the thing between memory and imagination, memory, Beatrice memory and the Donna Gentile imagination, because this would imply to resolve the thing in the sensitive soul, to which the two activities belong, functions of the soul, so that we have to look for other meanings. In this sense, I used Bonaventure, and the idea of a memory which exercising itself on the thing seen captures the sense, intellectual sense, of a memory, of the thing itself. This would be, of course, in contrast with the reading I have given, which is based mostly on an Aristotelian reading, and Dante himself invites us when he speaks about memory and imagination. However, it's impossible to assume that memory can be restricted in the field of Aristotelianism there. I have used it for that. Another aspect I have used of Bonaventure is when I speak about the theory of the heavens as sciences. Dico che per cielo io intendo le scienze e per cieli le scienze. This is Dante's in Convivio. And the idea that what means this? Nothing. I mean, we have to look for ideas in which the events are represented as related to sciences, as in many arts works of the Middle Ages. When I was reflecting on this issue, for case, as it happens many times, I believe in the accident as a scholar of Cavalcanti, and I thought that for accident I have found a passage in Thomas Aquinas in, I don't remember now, however, in which, in Albert the Great, in which events and angels' intelligences work together because the events is the heaven is a science because there is a science that is the angel intelligence. With the help of the work made by Mayeru, I was able to find on the reduction of sciences to theology of Saint Bonaventure, and the idea that all science derives from God, which is a common issue in the 12th century, and go back to God, but take a linguistic human shape when circulate inside. So this is for that I have used also Bonaventure, no more.
Thanks for that question. I was looking for remembering. I did not read the book.
Question is, it's very broad, I realize it goes above and beyond what you do in the scope of the book. What are the limits of intellectual curiosity? What are the limits of what we can and cannot acquire knowledge of? Because I'm thinking of episodes in the comedy where there are, of course, limits to
comedy is totally different from the Convivio.
Sure.
No, totally no, but different.
But so is
can
that
I
just
play next one? Maybe you should say some more about that.
Okay. Yes.
No, the question is
okay. Okay, I have to say at first that when I say philosophy, of course I have to use the word according to what Dante writes. And this has been another issue of great, great importance. From one side, in the allegorical commentary, he introduces philosophy as philos sophos. He looks for the etymology, quotes Pythagoras, and someone who is a philosopher is a lover of wisdom. Then he moves from that and he offers us many different answers to the question he himself has pushed us to search. And in fact he says, the donna gentile, philosophy is in the mind of God. He quotes Severinus Boetius for that. And he's also in the mind of human beings. This is an issue enormous. So philosophy is not something peaceful to be understood in the way in that. It seems that Dante looks for organizing a coincidence between the literal commentary in which no doubt the issue in both, I mean, I'm discussing now treatises two or three, not the four, which is, has a different background formation, in which he proposes that human beings think together, okay? And the fact that actually philosophy is in the mind of God. God thinks the sun. The sun is the logos, the so logos, the word, the verbum. A human beings, because the logos think together. So the answer is not just given, formulated through the field of heterodoxy, but he looks for, not for reconciliation again, but for giving to the reader two different lines of approach to the same issue. Then your question. In this case, I would say there is not a limit to knowledge. Because if the human being is able to look at the ideas in the mind of God, like the angels, and in my opinion, what Dante does is to proiettare all the problems related to the earthly condition in the cosmos. This is the most important aspect of the Convivio. But I mean, I am writing now on the monarchy for the book which I will publish with Theo. I'm writing the introduction. And what I have written on the Convivio is confirmed.
And yet, sorry, I didn't respond
to your question. So, yeah, okay.
And yet, you yourself insist that this all has to happen within the realm of ethics, right? Because ethics is really...
Of course, ethics is crucially important, so, but I mean not just ethics.
Which
is the category? Sorry. Okay, thanks for this question. And Theo, I know that you want another thing.
I'm very grateful to Alessandro for his...
Thanks, Alessandro, in fact. And ethics, Aristotle's Ethics, of course, Nicomachean Ethics, which is a crucial book, not just for Dante's Convivio, for the time, because, of course, the problem is the aptness of the human being, does not propose a limit to the human being. He says that this is written in the book 10, 7. The human being, through contemplation, is able to do what God does. So I don't see in that so much limits. It's true that when he speaks, Aristotle speaks about the moral virtues, this implies measure, Theo is our teacher here, measure and the right medium. The right medium is measure, but this is for moral virtues, but there are also intellectual virtues. On these, on the two aspects, the great debates of the 13th century, 12th century, after the discovery, the translation of Aristotle in Latin take form.
I wanted to hear the word contemplation.
The word is the contemplation. Contemplation is implies the Christian tradition and also the philosophical tradition, and however, maybe here the word could be consideration also. It's a long story.
Okay. Do you have the strength to take a few questions from the audience? Do you feel up to that?
I was sick this morning.
So maybe you don't.
No, I want. Of course I want. Maybe someone wants to ask questions to Professor Barolini about the questions she has asked.
I'm not asking angelic questions, but there are parallel instances and convergent ways in what I've done with the narrative and the story of the Convivio. But I have a very simple question. Could you please expand a little bit more on what you mean by thinking together? The idea that how to define this community where there is the intellectual level is not just interaction between...
No, no.
Right. What you said,
okay, I understand your question is something good expressed. No. When I say thinking together, I have two approaches, as I have anticipated before. From one side, this idea that we share the logos. My reading, for instance, of the Vita Nuova was that Beatrice represents the logos. She was the Christ, the Verbum. And for that, her death seems to be something which shows that we lost something so crucial, important. But at the same time, when I discuss the issue of politics in the Convivio, I move from Averroes. And from Averroes' idea that we share a single common intellect as human beings. And for that, we think together, because this is a theory complex to be said, but I can say in very simple way, we produce images, phantasms,
The mind does not think without an image. My students know that. And this is Aristotle in the Anima. But according to Averroes, human beings do not think alone. They think when they are able to copulate through their phantasms with this intellect, which is one and separated. So this is the great theme which is at the basis of, for instance, a work entitled Questio de Felicitate by Giacomo de Pristoi, in which we have step by step, we follow the process, in which, of course, Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics is read, but we should say is a left reading in the sense that is read by heterodox perspective. Okay, Dante does not deal more with the issue of the linking. He does not care that. He wants just, this is a waiver also heterodox as a position, he wants to understand. If we are able to love the gentle lady, which means if we are able to know a divine idea, who is the subject who knows? The individual or the common intellect? Is the common. He does not say, but is evident from what he writes. In this case, it's not interaction, but is thinking together, in the sense that the intellect is made by many phantasms, abstracted at the same time from the intellect. And we share intelligence in such intellect, but Dante does not deal with that. But it's evident that his idea of society is constructed not just, as I said before, on biological reasons, etc., but also by the idea that people need to construct the society because they think together. So I would say, is something which derives from the fact that we think together, that we need to live together. This is... Dante makes things like Facebook or no, I don't think he deals with that. Sorry, Sarah, you understand what I mean. No, I think he thinks in terms of an individual formation, but in which what is natural is a common, but the formation is individual. So he does not want people interact. The book remains in his table of writing, of work, his desk. You know that. He did not allow the circulation of the book, apparently he did not care the book. Who has constructed the history of the first diffusion of the Convivio is a scholar, an Italian scholar, who was invited to the theory of invited. The name is Luca Azzetta. He has made an enormous work to show that the Convivio entered in Florence immediately after the death of Dante, brought by the sun, and immediately a small circle of people started to consider this work anymore. And so the Convivio enters with a kind of
mythology of this book left unfinished that has to be understood. And in this sense, the circle can be the community you are recalling, but this does not imply that Dante was thinking in these terms. He was thinking about the formation of course, the idea that education is formative can be done through a book, and that education implies many things, that is the exercise of intelligence, learning, and a way to consider the learning, because Dante, of course, I did not speak about that, but the traditions he organizes in the Convivio are evident that there is a new idea about thinking in terms of what is tradition, what is culture, what is learning, or whatever. But he's thinking in terms of creating a new educated reader for a new political life. The idea is that he understands as heralds that means that life is worth to be lived here. There is a kind of a uncompleted in Dante's condition, which is extremely important. And anthropomorphism implies that life is worth to be lived at its great level here. We don't have to wait for our life. It is the most new things that the Convivio brings on the list.
Well, I just wondered if you would comment a bit more on the subject of how thinking together connects to governance. His ideas of governance, you know, he was writing the Convivio at a time of such peril and unrest and fighting and killing and disagreement about governance, about church, about state, about geography, about people's relationship to each other.
He does not speak about that, unfortunately.
Yes, well.
So he does not. I am not, you should ask him, but he does that when he writes the Monarchia. Of course, he offers a new, I mean, many things are implicit in the Convivio. For instance, in the book 4, he stops to write because he sees that the philosophy is becoming dangerous, threatening. And there, what penetrates is the idea of what is the first matter. So this is an enormous, complex issue. And then it seems that in the book going back to delete his previous positions. But after we see that in the Monarchia, he says, no, the human beings think together at the best. This is written in the first book of the Monarchia. And human beings are happy here in earthly life, book 3, and human beings are for what belongs to their earthly life depend on the emperor. He is looking for their happiness in the earth. This seems something obvious. Instead, not. Because it seems to herald that it's not the church, the mediator. So this opens a lot of other considerations, but this is not in the Convivio, this is in the next, the last work Dante's written, no, there is just the question is later. But I mean, the Monarchia is written between the second part of the Purgatorio and it seems, and the Paradise.